Good evening, it's Ray from Pro Shaper Workshop in Charlton, Massachusetts, and we've got a project here that's a little different. And we're getting some help from Eric. Eric is gonna be the man on the other side of the panel. And he's gonna be asking a bunch of questions that probably a lot of people in the audience would ask. That's what I hope he's gonna do anyways. This is an Austin Healey 3000 Shroud. And I think I mentioned in one of my earlier videos that I was able to have this opportunity to buy this old school body shop out in the Boston area. It was in Alston, Massachusetts, called Foreign Auto Body. And they had been in business actually for 70 years, but in that location about 50. And they decided that they were going to close up shop. And I don't know whether the father or the son, or maybe both of them, were supreme collectors. They collected everything. So anything that they thought had some value, they put in the basement. And so they ended up with a situation where they had a basement full of some really cool stuff. And it has a lot of value, but it was a major move to move all that stuff. And it's about 45 miles for me to move it. It was like 12 truckloads to move it all out here. And one of the things that we found in this pile was this Austin Healey 3000 Shroud. And these are subject to corrosion. They're all aluminum. They're subject to being dented really bad, overworked, corrosion where the fender is bolted up. And this one, I suspect, was probably taken off, removed from a wreck in the early 70s or so. There's no evidence of any corrosion anywhere, and it's got a horrible looking fold right here. But what happened is it got impacted right here on this side, and the fender took most of the blow, and that probably got totally destroyed. This looks like it's totally destroyed, but it's just rearranged essentially. So there's actually probably not too much stretching that happened here. It's just rearranged. So it also impacted it because it hit it this way. You can see there's some crimples over here, and it diamonded it a little bit this way. And this front section goes down. Now Eric found the grill, and it probably came out of another one that was part of the collection. So that will give us the register on how to get that all back in alignment. This goes down quite a bit, so it's probably like 50 degrees out of alignment here. This has to go from this plane down to this plane. And first off is we've got to remove this crinkle here. And I think this is 050 aluminum. That's what it looks like to me. And it's what happens is aluminum age hardens and it's really stiff. So what my plan is to pull this out as much as possible. Now, if I had a pulling table, and I did have a couple frame tables with pulling power, I could put it on the frame table, but I sold my frame tables. I didn't think I was going to use them anymore. So the frame machine is going to be Eric on one side and me on the other side with a torch and a slide hammer, and maybe incrementally we can unfold this. Now, aluminum melts at 1250. And if you heat it up to 300 or 400 degrees, it'll make it more malleable. It'll make it easier to pull this out. At 750 Fahrenheit, it anneals, and we have that option of annealing this whole thing, which we might do, but we'll try like 300 or 400 degrees. I think it's about 900 degrees. It goes into this crystal form. And if you bend it at that 900 degrees, it kind of breaks right off. So you got to be very careful you don't go into that 900 degree no-go zone. So we got three holes right here. And I was thinking that I could attach a piece of angle line or something here to spread the load a little bit. And first we got to straighten this out. So this is going to be a multi-part series. This is a very valuable part, and somebody will be happy to get it after it's all straightened out, I'm sure, because these are few and far between, especially an original one. And it's interesting, we'll flip it over. I want to let you see how the welds were done on this when they were done original. And I have no idea how they did these. I suspected they were stamped, but they did some kind of industrial aluminum welding. Maybe we'll get some comments. Oftentimes there's a lot of UK people watching my videos, and they might have worked at Healy or knew somebody that worked at Healy. And these wells are unusual. They could be gas wells. There's a bunch of pieces. There's this lower apron piece with a lower grill part, and then there's this headlight section right here, and then there's this front section, and there's a weld right here, and a weld right here. So there's a back section, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, at least 7 pieces. Let me count again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, yeah, 7 pieces. So it's a pretty elaborate piece. I don't think it was handmade. I don't think it was wheeled, because they made, I don't know what the production number is on Healy's, but it was probably stamped. But it's such an elaborate shaped piece that they have to make them in smaller pieces, and then they weld them together. And we'll have to look up the number. Maybe Mark can look up the number of production, and we'll throw that in there just as a good historical little factoid. And now, what we have here is, on this wells, they're really fat on this side. So they must have jigged it really good. If you jig it so that steel clamps on either side of it and it can't move, then they might have just gas welded it and really blobbed it through, and this is the drop through, and then they filed it smooth on the other side. Now we're probably going to paint remove this, and this is why you don't sandblast stuff, especially the aluminum. You'll be able to do a forensic report on it. You'll be able to see all those file marks or whatever we observe on the other side. On this side, we can see a picking hammer. They used a really sharp hammer to put some pressure on these panels to push them up so that they were low, so that they could file them all smooth on the other side. And it shows no previous accident damage. I believe this is an original color. It's quite an attractive green. And there's no Bondo present or anything. So this car was in really nice shape, a street driver car, and somebody clobbered him on that side. And maybe at the time they were able to buy this new from Healy, and they put a new one on, and they just felt that this had value. So they put it in the basement, and now here it is. And it'll probably end up on somebody's car that got really corroded, and they need this panel. So let's flip this back over again. I think what's going to happen is our main goal here is to pull this out first. Once we get this pulled out, then this will roll down pretty easy. This crinkle will get taken care of. And what we have here is a situation where this was secondary damage. This was not the initial, this isn't the impact that the other car, the offending car hit, or maybe this car hit it, I don't know. They might have hit a wall or something. But the fender took all the abuse. The fender transferred the force into this aluminum. Now remember, this had the correct area value and the correct arrangement value. And now what we have is still the correct area value with maybe a few spots that it got stretched in the process, but the arrangement value is way out of whack. So if we pull this out, it'll want to go back into that Healy arrangement value. And although we have a little bit of damage over there, we can still take, we can straighten that pretty easy once this goes down, and we'll be able to take profile gauges off of that side, and we'll be able to set the arrangement really close using those profile gauges from the other side. So the first order of business is attaching a piece of angle iron here, and then we'll throw some heat on it. Eric's going to hold it on that side, and I'm going to slide hammer this. We'll try that trick first. And I got a piece of angle iron, and I got to bend the angle iron a little bit to fit up in there. We'll have to drill a couple holes, and we'll try to get on this what was a plane, but it's kind of twisted now where the fender attaches. So we'll bring this back down.
maybe bring that angle down.
And it's moving pretty easy. It's still pretty malleable. And we'll move it forward a little bit to see the flanges in over here. Maybe I'll lift, have Eric lift it up, and then we'll hit that edge. Now we gotta bring that over to the edge. And swing the hammer. It's quite malleable. It's moving very nicely, so that's a good sign. So with a little heat, it should really move like crazy. Yeah. Okay, now we can let that down, and now let's see if we can attach this. The reason why I want to attach this is this will spread the load, so we won't rip it. We don't want to rip it. If it rips, it's not the end of the world, but we'll try not to do that. So we got to open this up. We'll put it in two blocks of wood, and we'll hammer this down. We'll make this tool off camera. And then it looks like we'll probably have to make a cut here, too, to bend it this way. So this angle iron will bend down and then bend this way, so we can get it against this flange. We'll drill three holes in and put some bolts on there. And now we can pull with the slide hammer, just little pulls at a time, and we'll heat this up. And we'll give it a go. Okay. It might be a smart move to work from this back side because it's all exposed there. A lot of the paint's been knocked off. So this will take the heat really nice. Eric will be able to hold that really good on the other side. The problem is the slide hammer won't get a bite on this here, so I might weld on another piece of angle iron that I can grab the slide hammer around and then pull like crazy on that thing. So let's make the tool up and we'll be back in a minute. Okay, so we've put this on here. We got it fitting on the flange nice. We got it bolted with 3/5/16 bolts. And I figured if I was wailing on this here like this, it would tend to push it this way. So I welded this bar on so I can counter the forces. Unfortunately, I only have two arms. So this is gonna be a little tricky. These are nice blood blister makers if you get caught by it. So I'm gonna try not to do that. Make sure this is all nice and tight here. Looks like it's loose. All right. I've had this slide hammer for, I don't know, probably 40 years or so. So let's just see what happens without any heat. So far, nothing. Not much of a hit. Let's try a better hit. We need to quantify it. So if it moved an eighth of an inch, we wouldn't be able to tell. So let me go get a caliper. We'll tick off two spots. And we'll see if we get any motion out of it. All right, I'm ticking a spot right here. And I'm going to tick a spot. Ooh, that's hot! I'm going to tick a spot. I welded that on previously. I forgot that it's still hot. So I'm going to grab it right there. Right there. All right, it's a little tight. Right there. So, we'll mark that. Right there, and right there. And we'll see if that opens up any. The measurement is 9 5/8. All right, so we'll give it a couple more blasts and see if we get any motion out of this thing. Let's see, Eric, if you pull it that way, we'll put some pressure on that bar. Okay, that's good. Ready? Here we go. Did anything happen? measurement will tell us. Look at that. It moved a tiny bit. See it? It's almost a quarter of an inch of movement. Now, at that rate, it could be 2 or 3 weeks before we get this out. So let's try a little heat on this hill right here and see if that helps us. And we'll give that a go. Let's see, we got, I didn't reset the caliper, but look at that. That came out a good 5/8 of an inch now, all total. So that's looking pretty good. I gotta tighten my bolts up. My bolts loosened up a little bit here.
Hate it when that happens.
All right, so we're gonna heat it again, and we put a little clamp on the bench here to make it easier to hold it back. So we could ideally do this with hydraulics and kind of slowly pull it out, but not everybody has the hydraulics either, so. Something likes to burn on that other side there. There's the big knot right there. That knot's got to come out. We'll try that. Yeah, Eric, maybe you can hold that. See what that did. We're still set at the same measurement. Didn't move. All right, let's try it some more here. A little bit. It seemed to be more than before. So, did we hit the limit already? I don't know. Let's see. We gotta get that knot out there. Let me get a rubber hammer and we'll hammer that down. Wow.
What's burning?
Is something still burning?
No, it was the Bondo or the filler.
Eric, maybe you can pull the slide hammer, and I'll hit it at the same time that you hit it with the slide hammer. Come on over here. Grab the slide. Sit tight. Hold on. I'm going to have to put my foot against the bench here. Okay, so Eric's going to slide hammer it, and I'm going to hit it right here a little bit. Let's see what goes. Made some progress then, I'm pretty sure. Look at that. Ha! We're about an inch and a half in so far. So that worked out pretty good. Our bolts loosened up again. We gotta tighten those up. So it's in quite a bit this way. It's gotta go that way and down. We gotta make sure you don't get caught by that slide hammer. Go ahead.
Ready?
Yep. Inches.
You gotta start working on this up here.
That I think we can pull by ourselves that way. Let's see.
Let's move the table that way.
Yeah. Okay. Let's just see if we can pull this. This way, like this.
This?
Yeah, like that. It looks like it's all going to be sewed back on there. It's just about broken off. Let me get a block of wood and hit this corner out here. Where those little edges go that I didn't use. Pull in the corner there, Eric, and then see if I can. Wrinkle out right there.
So I should bring it all up.
Oh, yeah.
Good.
That didn't. I gotta get. That's the main culprit right now, right there. Might have to get that from the other side. Well, I go this way. Hold it back. I'm gonna, because that's crunched up this way. There we go.
When you're holding it, the camera's jumping. Yeah.
Now, I think we should tip it over and knock this back this way. Okay, now. Thank you.
place to go back this way. That little blast is going to come out. I'm going to get it from the other side. So this is going to uncurl a little bit. Yeah. Bring that up. Then I can bring this out here.
We're going to flip her over again. Basically what we're doing here is sculpting. We're looking for the original shape over there, looking to see where it's deviating and correcting. We got this little kink going on here, so gotta straighten that out. Now in the process of doing this, we're gonna be stretching a little bit. We might even be shrinking a little bit, but we'll iron this all out after. But we got to get the general shape in here, so. You see we're making pretty good progress with some pretty simple tools. Basically a rubber hammer, a slide hammer, a block of wood, and a blacksmithing hammer. And we have patience, and we have precision measurement. That's how much we moved. And we have persistence. We're going to stay at it. So we still got a little bit of a knot right here. What you don't want to do is let this come over. It really got torn really badly right in here. But that'll all sew together again. We got this to pull up here. Probably should hit that with the heat a little bit. That might break off. That's just hanging by a thread there now. So we got to iron this out a little bit more. Might have to get that from the other side again now. We'll flip her over. So it's got that valley. We gotta put that valley in here. These little knots out.
definitely looks like we're gonna break off down here. So the trick here is we're gonna iron that out. That was the worst part of it right there. It's really jumbled pretty bad right in here. And that will require planishing basically, or gross planishing with that piece of wood. One side, then the other side. One side, then the other side. Until we get, if we look at this side here, this side is coming down like that. This side is way down in here. So this needs to come up a lot, probably an inch or more, maybe an inch and a half, up this way. And this is going to have to come out again. I just knocked it back this way, but it's got to go that way. But again, it's getting late, and we didn't expect to do this all in one night. It's going to take probably about 3 episodes to get this ironed out pretty good, and maybe another couple episodes to get it totally planished and all the gauges checked to make sure that the arrangement is all in where it's supposed to be. So I want to thank Eric for helping me tonight, and Mark for staying a little later. And remember to keep subscribing, hit that little subscribe button, and give us the likes, give us some comments, hit the little notification bell, tells you when the new videos. We're trying to do 2 a week. We'd love to do more, but we're really busy. And remember, if you haven't watched the last video, we've got a new contest out. And all the rules are on our website, proshaper.com. We're giving away a 10-day apprenticeship. All you have to do is give us a 3-minute video, and you just send us the email, it's the URL, to contest@proshaper.com. And then we're going to decide who's going to be winning the 10 days. We're going to try to get our audience involved in the process, and we'll be videoing. Whoever wins will be videoing his progress from, or her progress, whoever comes, and we'll show how their skills developed over the 10-day period. And we're going to be working on that little Volkswagen wire form we showed in an earlier video. And I think it's going to be a lot of fun and maybe set the example for a regular thing. We don't know. So hopefully it's successful, and hope the audience loves it. And remember that metal is clay. You have to heat it up just like clay, and it'll do anything you want if you abuse it. Just like if you abuse clay, clay breaks. If you abuse metal, it breaks. So metal is clay. You got to have that thinking, and you remember that you have to have patience in order to do this work. If you don't have patience, forget about it. Go play chess or collect coins or stamps or something. Play in the Bitcoin field. This is a passion business, or a passion hobby. It's very addictive to do this stuff, to reclaim these cars or make them from scratch. It's a lot of fun. So you have to have the patience. Passion is another one. So passion, patience, precision measurement, and persistence. Thanks for watching. It's Ray Shaleen from Pro Shaper Workshop.